truly amazing what God is doing in the lives of these students. Let's stand and with full voices give Him the glory. Is it? Who am I that you are mindful of me?
God. Amen. Be seated this morning. We just sang that we're going to worship Him today, and that's exactly what we're here to do. So we welcome you this morning. Welcome to Kingsland Baptist Church. We're glad that you're here. We've already heard some exciting things from the youth. I can't wait to hear some more from their week this week. And you want to come back tonight for our 60-minute service. We're going to hear from our mission team that went down to Tennessee a couple of weeks ago. They're going to share what they did, some of the things that they saw and performed on their mission trip that was just a couple of weeks ago. If you have your bulletin, open it up real quick. I want to point out a couple of things. First of all, Vacation Bible School, VBS as we know it, starts next Sunday. A couple of things to point out. First of all, if you are a worker and you're planning on taking part in the prepared meals each night, you need to turn in your request form for your meals by this Wednesday. Christy will be here Wednesday night walking around, making herself available so you can turn those in. You can also turn them in today if you have them to Dorothy or I believe Beverly Pierce and take those forms for you. But they need those by Wednesday. Also, if you're a worker, the information forms are available out on the table so that you can understand and have all your questions answered so you know exactly what's going to take place next week. And lastly, if you're a worker and have not gone through our child protection class previously, you must have this class before working with our children at VBS. The class is tonight, but it's at 5 p.m. The bulletin says 5:30. It's at 5 o'clock p.m. here at the church. So if you need that child protection class, come back at 5 o'clock tonight and get that taken care of. The other thing I'll point out this morning, if you notice, our ladies' ministry bulletin board has changed. It's bright colors this morning and a lot of new information on it. The next girls' night out is Friday, August the 3rd, and you'll see the information in your bulletin that gives you all the details and all the fun stuff that's going to be happening on that Friday night. So check out the Women's Ministry Bulletin Board. If you have any questions, you can see Jenny Sneed, and she'll take care of any questions that you have about the women's ministry. And with that, I'd ask you to join me in prayer, and we will start or continue our service this morning. Heavenly Father, we do worship You this morning. And as we've already sung this morning, it's You we adore. It's You we worship this morning. We're not worshiping ourselves. We're not worshiping this earth. We're worshiping You. And it is all about You. And so, Father, as we spend time together this morning in Your Word, hearing about what You've done in our lives, the lives of our students, Lord, we praise Your name. We recognize that You are the giver of life, and You are the giver of all good things. And we thank You for that. And, Lord, we just want to give You all the glory that You deserve this morning. And Father, I pray, if there's one here today that doesn't have a relationship with You, today would be the day that they get that settled. Lord, we know that You do not desire for any to perish, but You want to have a relationship with each one of us. We thank You for that. And we praise You in Christ's name. Amen.
In the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4, it talks about God, who is rich in mercy because of His great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And it even repeats that in verse 8, for by grace you have been saved through faith. Let's stand and let's sing of God's grace.
Yeah. Lord, we humbly come before you this morning. Fully aware that you are so worthy and honor of our praise, Lord, and how you bless us each day individually and as a church, Lord. And we just ask you to bless this offering, that it be used to further your work here on the Pike and throughout Virginia and just all around the world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Despised by the world, holds a wondrous attraction for me. Where the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it on our Calvary. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday. Yes, exchange it someday. I'll exchange it someday for a crown. Cling to the old rugged
Thank you so much, Tommy. Haven't you enjoyed worshiping the Lord who died on that cross today? We have so much to be thankful about. And thank you for singing. Our service guests, if you're here with us today for the first time, thank you for being here. Our service is a little bit different, and I have some honored guests with me today. Ever since my family, mom and dad, packed up and moved to Iowa, the closest family I have live on Lake Anna. Don't you wish you lived on Lake Anna? But and my Aunt Linda has brought the rest of my family here today, and I'm just so honored that they would come to our church. And my favorite cousin is here. And I'm really just getting to know my favorite cousin that much. But I went up to his house last summer, had a great time, and found out he has season tickets to the Washington Redskins. Lives within a mile of FedEx Field. And more importantly than that, he is a United States Capitol police officer. And I have a lot of respect and regard for my brothers in law enforcement. And I'm just so thankful that all of my family could be here today, these folks, and all of you, to worship the Lord. And we are thanking God for the unbelievable things He did at summer camp. They call it camp. I don't know why. You basically live in luxury the whole week, in air conditioning and trouncing back and forth to these amazing speakers and bands and all this stuff. But God did wonderful things in the lives of our teenagers this week. And a couple of them are going to come and share a little bit about what God did in their lives before we break open the Word together. So I'm going to ask Toria and Becca to come on up. And I guess, Becca, you can go first. Is that okay? And they're going to share a little bit about what God did in their lives. Just come right up here on stage and speak into that microphone.
This week at camp was a really powerful experience. People were saved and other people were called into full-time ministry. I think every single person learned something this week. One of the things that really hit home for me was how much people want to control their lives when God is ultimately in control of everything. I want God to take more control in my life and have a greater role in every aspect of it. I'm planning on spending more time reading the Bible and praying to God all the time, in my quiet time and throughout the whole day. I want God to be my ultimate role model and my best friend.
This week at camp, everyone was touched in at least one way. I realized that worship was about you and God and just that. That worship that comes from the inside should show on the outside. Tony Nolan, who was our speaker, taught me dozens of things. But one thing he said stuck out in my mind. He said, "The devil is trying to tell you that the past is what's true about you." Then he followed that with, "What's true about you is what God says about you." So many times we let our past dictate who we are now. God wants to paint a canvas on you, but with marvelous colors to show how He rolls, is the way Tony Nolan put it. He's one speaker that really relates to teenagers, and he makes the truth very clear. The last night was very peaceful and reverent. Tony Nolan directed his message to those that God had called into full-time ministry. One encouragement he said to all of us was, "Don't just be for your youth leaders, be with them." That meant two things to me. One, be a leader in your youth group, and to support your youth leaders physically. Find your ministry and do it. I plan on being a part in improving our youth group even before our youth pastor comes, so he will think of us as a youth group that is illuminated for God.
Thank you, girls. That was wonderful. And so many of the rest of our teenagers could come and speak. And some of them you couldn't pay $1,000 to come up here and speak. But they all had just a great week, and God moved mightily in our presence. Have you ever had a hard time getting someone's attention? I forgot, after being youth pastor for 5 years of my life, how hard it was to get teenagers' attention until this last week. Have you ever had a hard time getting your kids' attention? Maybe your pet? I've got a pet who doesn't think he owes me his attention. He never gives me his attention. I mean, maybe yours is like that. Have you ever had a hard time getting the attention of a child, or maybe your spouse or someone? You wanted to get their attention. You wanted them to respond to you, but they didn't. I want to talk about that today from Matthew chapter 4. If you turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 4, I want to talk today about responding to God's call. Responding to God's call. I believe our Heavenly Father is trying to get our attention. And we've got the headphones on. We're looking the other way. We're not paying attention. We need to respond to Him. You see, the call of Christ for disciples began in the first century and continues at this very moment. Follow me. Do you remember that? That's what we're going to look at today. Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. God patiently waits for us. Up to this point, His patience will run out. But currently, God is patiently waiting for us to respond to His call. Listen to the words of God's Word. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17 says, "From that time Jesus began to preach and to say, 'Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand.' And Jesus, walking by the Sea of Galilee, saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, because they were fishermen. Then He said to them, 'Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men.' They immediately left their nets and followed Him. Going on from there, He saw two brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And He called them. And immediately they left their boat and their father, and they followed Him." Look at the very first verse of the next paragraph there. "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people." That's a snapshot of Christ's ministry. Teaching, preaching, and healing. And He called disciples. "Follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men." That's what He said. And they did it. And today, I believe God is calling us. He's trying to get our attention. And I would ask you, are you responsive to the call of Christ? Have you answered the call to be His disciple? See, we use all kinds of church words, Bible words sometimes. Get saved, be born again, encounter with God, invite Jesus into your heart. We use a lot of that terminology, and that's great. But this passage says, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." And these men became Christ's disciples, His apostles, but His disciples, His followers, His loyal followers. They left everything and followed Him. What if God asked you to do that? To quit your job, to leave your family, and to follow Him out somewhere. Better yet, what if God asked you, your kid to do that? Your son or your daughter. Every year that I've gone to summer camp with the students, I'm always afraid I'm going to have to come back and tell one of these parents, "I don't know how to break it to you, but your son, your daughter has decided they want to commit their lives to God and go into full-time ministry." Because some parents, you think that parents would be like, "Woo, that's great." Others are like, "What? You mean to where? To Africa? What? To Europe? To Russia? To China? To be a missionary? Are you kidding me?" You know, not everybody's all that excited about their kids being a missionary off in South America somewhere. Isn't that sad? We should be so excited that for God to call us, for God to call our kids. How about your grandkids? What if God put His hand on the life of one of your grandchildren? How would that make you feel? Well, this is exactly what He did to the individuals in our story today. He called them, and they left everything to follow Him. And by the way, I believe that children neglect to respond to God's calling because they don't see their parents responding to God's calling. If we would be better examples, we would probably see a lot of our students and our children responding to the Lord. You know, our summer camp experience this week was awesome, and they were very straightforwardly called. They were challenged, and the Holy Spirit of God worked in our lives, and He called them. He moved in their lives. And every time we go to camp, well, I think, man, let's bottle up that excitement. Let's bottle up that fire and take it home with us. You know, the way our students respond to God's call on their lives will dictate what this church is over the next 30 or 40 years. You know, we're doing VBS next week, and that's exciting. And we just took our kids to camp, our students to camp. That was exciting. What's the point? We're trying to expose them to the teaching and preaching of the Word of God, the power of the Holy Spirit in their lives, calling them. We're making tremendous sacrifices to make that happen. A lot of money was spent. Scholarships were spent. Church budget money was spent to make these things happen. Because we realize how important it is to reach the next generation. And I believe it's time for young and old alike and everybody in between to respond to our Lord's calling afresh. It's time for us to open up our ears. You know, you can listen or you can ignore. You can plug your ears. You can respond or you can delay. You can obey or you can disobey. God didn't create you to be a computer or a robot. You have a free will. But I believe that Jesus is still calling men and women and boys and girls. And, you know, what our nation needs is revival. What our world needs is revival. I believe that strongly. Do you believe that? We need revival. We need God to turn things around. Look at what's happening in Iraq. Look what's happening in the Middle East. And we're told to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And I do. And we should. But you know what? Man, the Bible tells us in the last days it's going to get worse and worse and worse. And I'm praying for an end times revival on the world, an end times gathering, a revival in America. We need revival at Kingsland Baptist Church. No amens on that. Do you believe that? Do we? We do. And God is in charge of giving the revival. We can't snap our fingers and make it happen. Ultimately, revival is the end result of what happens in people's lives as they respond to God's call. That's what happens. When we respond, when we listen, when we act, He acts. And He does great things. Look back at the text with me. I want to give you a little background on this. In Matthew chapter 4, Jesus has just successfully finished His time in the wilderness and fasting for 40 days. He was under satanic attack. And He succeeded. He defeated Satan. And in this passage, He's leaving Nazareth, where we know from the Gospel of Luke, He was basically completely kicked out of town. He was almost killed. And he heads over to Galilee to begin His earthly public ministry. Now, what's neat about this is 700 years earlier, the prophet Isaiah predicted that Jesus would do that, that there would be light in Galilee. So Jesus is fulfilling prophecy by doing this. And we are reading the earliest historical events surrounding the inauguration of Christ's public ministry. This is the very beginning of it. And in this passage, Christ carries on the message that, remember, John the Baptist had been preaching, and that is repent. Repent. That's what John the Baptist said. Well, Christ carries on that teaching and that message, and begins calling disciples who would take His message to the ends of the earth. Now, what's neat is He finds these people where they are. Remember, our Savior wasn't up on a holy mountain just sitting there looking at the world and not having anything to do with people and kind of being priestly and never touching people. No, the Lord was right down there with them. And He found them right where they were, and they were fishermen. And their life experience, their career, what they did for a living made a pretty big impact on their ministry. What did he relate to them? He said, I want to make you fishers of men. It's interesting how God does that. Our experiences, I can tell you in my life, my experiences, all the goofy jobs that I've held in my life, I've served tables, I've waited tables, I drove a Schwann's truck for a little while, I've cleaned horse stalls, I've sold door to door, I've done all kinds of things, and the Lord opened doors, pumping gas. You learn something by pumping gas for people. That you don't want to pump gas for people for the rest of your life. But you learn. And these men had learned through their real life experiences and taken up to that point. And I wonder in your life, what real life experiences, your job, your career, your relationship, have brought you to this point in your life. You're here today. At this moment, in this time, is God calling you? I hope He is. I hope He is. And the question is not, what are you good at? What are you so good at that you can somehow impress God? Think about that. God, Almighty God. We can't really impress Him, can we? The question really is, how should we respond to the calling of the Lord? How are we going to respond to the calling of the Lord? You can say, yes, sir, or you can say, no, sir. Or you can say, yes, sir, and then keep doing whatever you want. You see, your words mean very little. But what we see is that these men didn't just say, yeah, Jesus, we're with you, and then back into fishing with their nets. No, they left. They did what they were called to do, and they responded with their lives. Their lives totally changed. And this morning I want to offer five responses right from this text. How should we respond to the calling of the Lord? Well, look at verse 17. We see response number one, preach the word. Look at verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Preach the word. We need to do the same thing that Jesus did 2,000 years ago. And we can. He's enabled us to do exactly what He did. The message has not changed. Repent. And it's not a very popular message. And you may not hear it very much anymore. But it's the same message from 2,000 years ago. Repent. And the methods have changed. The methods. The way we reach people. This church, I guarantee you, the way we've done things this morning is very different than what they did 30 years ago. They weren't even in this building 30 years ago. But Kingsland wasn't doing church the way we're doing church now 30 years ago. The methods have changed because we want to reach the next generation. We want to reach people. We don't want to be trying to reach people with 1970s methods in the year 2007. But the message has never changed and will never change. Repent. And it's kind of an ugly message because it's confrontational. And when we preach the gospel, first of all, the gospel is good news, man. Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. He was buried. He rose from the grave. I think that's good news. The only problem is, if you don't realize you have a problem, called sin, that good news means nothing to you because you don't need Him anyway. It means nothing to you. Do you understand that, without repentance, without Christ forgiving you, you will spend a Christless eternity separated from Him forever and ever and ever because of your sin. We're all sinners. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. If you admit it, you don't. Nobody's going to ask you to stand on the stand and admit that right now. But the gospel is useless. Please follow me. The gospel is useless. It's weak. It's meaningless without sin. The good news that Jesus Christ died for you, rose from the grave, paid for your sins. Unless you realize you're a sinner in need of salvation, the gospel is completely useless. In Luke 5:32, Jesus said, "I've not come to call righteous, but sinners to repentance." You may be here today and you say, "Man, I'm a sinner. I've done a lot of bad things. You don't even want to know what I've done." And you know what? You're a perfect candidate for the gospel. You're a perfect candidate to be born again, to become a disciple, a follower of Christ. Now, the person who is righteous, in this text, it's really saying the person who thinks they're righteous, who has lied to themselves and fools themselves into thinking, "Yeah, I'm righteous, I'm good." Well, that person is unsavable until he comes to the point, or she comes to the point, where they admit they're a sinner in need of salvation. Look down at verse 23. Did we read verse 23 already? "And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of diseases among them." You see, Jesus Christ preached the gospel of the kingdom. He was rejected, but He preached the gospel of repentance. You know, Tony Nolan, the speaker that I think the girl spoke about, we saw on the video there earlier in the service. This man preached with power. He's the most sought-after youth speaker in the world, or in the United States. And he was good. God used him greatly. He spoke to over 1,000 campers last week. Out of that 1,000 campers, 140 of them gave their heart to Christ. They were born again. There were hundreds of others that made other kinds of decisions. But a lot of people made ministry decisions. Some of our kids made ministry decisions. But 140 campers got saved. There were staff members at the camp that went to camp to serve students that got saved. They were born again at this trip. It was unbelievable. God poured out in a mighty, powerful, awesome way. Every one of our adult leaders that went, and every staffer that went from our church to work, led someone to Christ this week. It was unbelievable. God was moving in powerful ways. And here's the message. Anyone can do it. Anyone can do it. You see, Jesus Christ set the standard. He preached the kingdom, and He told us to do the same. And by the way, He didn't have a church like this. He didn't have pews, didn't have microphones, didn't have a suit, didn't have a choir, no television cameras. There's a lot of things we have He didn't have. They certainly didn't have padded pews. But guess what? He preached the gospel. We can all do that. It doesn't mean get up on a stage and preach like this necessarily. This is one way to do it. But there's a lot of ways to connect with people. And He had the two essentials, the Word of God and responsive hearts. And not everybody has a responsive heart. Some people are very hard-hearted. They're not open to the message of the gospel. And they're they don't want anything to do with it. Can't do much about that. You can pray for that person. But you take the Word of God and a responsive heart, and any one of us can be used as a tool to share the gospel. So how should we respond to the call of the Lord? Well, right there in verse 17, preach the gospel. Secondly, follow the Master. Follow the Master. Look at verse 19. He said to them, "Follow me." Now, by the way, this wasn't the first time Peter and his brother met Jesus. They've been disciples of John the Baptist. They knew of Jesus. They had a relationship with Jesus. But Christ is calling them into a much deeper relationship, of a permanent kind of relationship. He said, "Follow me. Follow me." You know, I prayed with a 12-year-old boy this week that, man, he was crying. I don't see 12-year-olds cry at church very often or get convicted. But, man, this kid was just broken. He wanted to follow the Master. He prayed to receive Christ. And it was precious. This young man's mom and dad had put him through they'd been divorced, had put him through all of that. He was just distraught. He had made some bad decisions at 12 that he was all broken up over. And man, he was totally feeling guilty and rejected. And he needed the love of Christ. He gave his heart to Christ. And man, it was the most beautiful thing in the world. I hope he'll email me and let me know how his life has changed. You know, many of our students made important decisions this week saying, "I want to follow the Master." That's the main thing. I just want to follow the Master. I want to do things His way. And by the way, the best leaders are followers. It's okay to be a follower. And not everybody's cut out to be a big leader, right? But you will never be a good leader until you learn to be a follower of the Master. Response number three is found in the second part of that verse. Jesus said, I will make you fishers of men. How do we respond to Christ? How do we respond to His call? By fishing for souls. Just fish for souls. That sounds like kind of a funny thing, really, to the average person, I would think. Fishing for souls. You know, a good fisherman, and I'm not. I want to teach my son how to fish. I'm going to have some other people help me with that. But I want to be a good fisherman. But a good fisherman, a real outdoorsman, can catch some fish. I mean, they don't just throw their hook out in the water and just sit around all day, okay? They're going to catch some fish. But, and by the way, they're going to bait it a certain way. They're going to make some effort to reel. You know what? These people love their rods and their reels and their hooks and their bait, and it stinks. But they love it. They don't care. They're fishermen. Folks, we've got to learn to love fishing for souls. Whether they catch anything or not, yeah, they want to catch, but the bottom line, they love the whole process. Going out there in the elements, all the stuff that goes along with it. They love it because they're fishermen. We need to love fishing for souls. Why does Kingsland Baptist Church go through all the effort to put on VBS, to take the kids to camp, to spend all that money? Why do we do that? Because we want to fish for souls. And we realize, catch this, 85% of the people that come to Christ do so before the age of 18. So how are we going to reach the next generation? How is there going to be a church here 20 years from now? We're going to have to reach those people. And 85% of the people that come to Christ, it doesn't mean senior citizens don't get saved. They do sometimes. That's awesome. That's miraculous. Adults sometimes get saved. That's wonderful. But the vast majority of people that come to Christ, and we saw it again this week at camp, are teenagers. They're children. And actually, the vast majority above that are children. And we know that the most productive time to fish for men is while they're young. And we want to reach them while they're still reachable. You know, we're doing this leader training on August 17 and 18 because we need more leaders. And we need more leaders who are more well-trained. Hope you'll mark it down. Make sure you're there. Every leader in our church should have received a letter. If you didn't, write, give me your name and I'll make sure you get one. We're going to have a renewed emphasis on care groups this fall through our Bible study. We're going to expand our Bible study. We're going to reach more people because we are compelled to do what's told here. To fish for souls. To love people. I got a buddy by the name of Troy Allison. He's a minister. And had a cushy, no minister's job is really cushy, but he had a very good, dependable church job right down the street from us. And do you know what he did? He left the whole thing behind. He's from Ohio. And he got his wife and his little baby, his little adopted baby boy, and drove to Ohio. They're going to start a church. Man, I got a lot of respect for this guy. He is fishing for souls. He's going back to his own watering hole to reach people for Jesus, to fish for souls. And he came back with his youth group at camp this week. And I looked over across the stadium, and I saw Troy with his little boy in one arm, and his hand, they were singing, I Surrender All. And his hand was raised, he was singing, I Surrender All. All to Thee, my blessed Savior, I Surrender All. And you know what? He meant it. We sing these songs. Do you mean it? Do you mean what you're singing? It was an absolutely awesome thing to see God work in his life, and God's already giving him success. How should we respond to the calling of the Lord? Well, preach the Word. Follow the Master. Fish for souls. Response number four is found in verse 20. Look down at verse 20. Let's read it together. We see that you must embrace the ultimate. Embrace the ultimate. They immediately left their nets and followed him. They immediately left their nets. Now think about that. They didn't have a deliberation. They didn't have a little brainstorming session. They had some background with Jesus. They know he wasn't some crazy man. But they immediately left their nets. They embraced the ultimate. They made a life-altering decision right there on the spot to give their hearts to Christ and to follow Christ. I don't know if you've heard the quote that says, never sacrifice the ultimate for the urgent. Never sacrifice the ultimate for the urgent. I don't know about you, but I spend my life like a pinball in a pin machine with the little clicker things. Just going from one thing to the next. And sometimes I'm praying that God is the one hitting the flippers, okay? But sometimes He's not. There's other people hitting those flippers sometimes. Smacking me all over the place. Putting out one fire after the next. Concentrating on what's urgent. Folks, sometimes we have to put the urgent on the back burner and focus on and actually embrace the ultimate. We're consumed with the immediate, the temporal, the short term, and we need to stop that and look to the long term. What's really important? These men immediately left their nets It reminds me of Billy Sunday. Have you ever heard of Billy Sunday, the great revival preacher? Did you know that Billy Sunday was a professional baseball player? He was very fast. He was very good. He's very, very highly respected in the National League. I'm not sure which team he played for. But in 1886, Billy Sunday happened by the Pacific Garden Mission. Have you ever heard of the Pacific Garden Mission? They put out a radio show called Unshackled. And to this day, they do this, but this is 100-something years ago. Billy Sunday happened by there, and he heard the gospel. He gave his heart to Christ. He began preaching in YMCAs. He had all kinds of success at that. He quit baseball. He retired after 8 years in the majors, and he went into evangelism. This man was used to speak to to millions of people. 1 million people were converted during his rallies. At the time of his death, nobody had spoken to more people face-to-face than Billy Sunday. Now we have Billy Graham, who has actually exceeded that. This man embraced the ultimate. He gave up a baseball career to become a preacher. So the question is, what are you willing to give up? You know, when you look to the fall, we have 7 weeks before the fall. Our fall ministry programs will start. We have so many people that we need to reach. And the only way it's going to happen is if our people will embrace the ultimate. Give a little of their free time, give a little of their money, give a little of their energy, and embrace the ultimate. What's really and truly important. Lastly, response number 5 is found in verse 21 and 22. Answer the call. Answer the call. Preach the gospel, follow the master, fish for souls. Answer the call. Embrace the ultimate, answer the call. Look at verse 21 and 22. It says, He called them. Jesus called them. Now He's talking to James and John. And immediately they followed Him. They immediately followed Him. Peter, Andrew, James, John had to take a big chance in following Christ. And they answered the call, by the way, at great sacrifice. All you have to do is read Acts, I think, 12 and find out what happened to James. He was the first martyr, the first apostle martyred by King Herod Agrippa I. These men paid dearly for their decision to follow Christ. It reminds me of the two missionaries out in Turkey, I believe Turkey, just a couple months ago, who were tortured and executed in the most hideous, barbaric way by Muslim extremists because they were preaching the gospel out there and those people didn't appreciate it. Modern martyrs. It happens, folks. My question to you is, are you willing to answer the call? And what are you willing to sacrifice by answering God's call? Are you willing to sacrifice some of your time? Are you willing to sacrifice your plans for His plans? Your habits? And some habits are good. Some habits are bad. Biting your fingernails. Bad. But some habits are good. Are you willing to sacrifice your pride? How about some hobbies? Hobbies are great. But when they dominate your life, when that is all you are and there's nothing else, man, one day you're going to die. One day you're going to leave your family behind. And are they just going to look back and say, well, he was really into his little hobby. Well, she really was into that thing with the whatever. What are they going to say about you when you're gone? Are you willing to sacrifice your sin? That's really what we're talking about. To follow Christ, to turn your back on your sin, not to be perfect as far as doing all the right things all the right time, to be made perfect by entering into a relationship with Christ and then becoming His disciple, following Him, turning your back on a sinful lifestyle. Are you willing to sacrifice your energy, your money, to put your money where your mouth is? Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, most of you know it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. Acknowledge Him in all your ways and He will direct your paths. So it's our way or His way. We either trust Him, lean on Him, acknowledge Him in what we're doing, follow Him, answer the call, or we do things our way. You know, the phone's ringing. Aren't cell phones great? I left mine in the pew over there. The world's changed, man. People can get you anywhere. The phone is ringing, and God is on the other line, and there is no celestial answering service, okay? It's either pick it up and talk to Him, or don't answer Him. Or pick it up, talk to Him, and say, no, God, no thanks. I don't want anything to do with that. Or to say, yes, Lord, I will follow You. And they got out of the boats, they left their nets, and they followed Him. And their lives were never, ever the same. So what is God calling you to do? As we come to a close, that's the real question. Not what am I calling you to do, what is God calling you to do? The needs are everywhere. The needs are vast. We have vast needs in our ministry for leadership, for people to step up, to be trained. Not just warm bodies that have a pulse. Oh, sure, I'll do that. No, we need people who are trained to do that. That's why we're doing the child protection class again tonight. We want people to know what they're doing with our kids. Aren't you thankful for that, those of you that have kids? They do background checks. Make sure we don't have any axe murders in there, okay? What is God calling you to do? I focused on this the last few weeks. as we're going into the fall, I want to focus on it some more because we need to get ready. We need to sacrifice. Will you answer the call today? That's the question. How will you respond? How will you respond? We need God-called disciples to take on leadership at Kingsham Baptist Church. Teachers, care group leaders, children's workers, youth workers. Man, do we need youth workers. You want to introduce people to Christ? Get involved in youth ministry. It's the best place to be to introduce people to Christ. The children's ministry. We need nursery helpers. We need youth joining the ministry team. Awana's just around the corner. Upward basketball right after that. Van drivers. Oh, man, that's a job right there. You're not just driving the van. You're like, yeah, it's a tough job. And we need people to help be the van driver helpers. It's pretty crazy in there. I started that ministry a few years ago, and I can tell you, it got crazy. But it's an adventure. Some people think the Christian life is like boring. Man, it's not. When you're serving the Lord, when you're in the center of God's will, it's an adventure. It's awesome. Following the Lord equals serving people. You can write that down. Following the Lord, being a disciple, equals serving people. If you live for yourself, man, you're not a disciple. That's just selfishness. Yesterday, I taught my son how to ride a bike. Man, it was awesome. I'm kind of ashamed because I should have done it a year ago. I think he probably could have done it a year ago, but I didn't for some reason. The silly training wheels. Started getting embarrassing, riding around training wheels. So I unscrewed those things, and man, we went for it. And it got ugly a couple times. But I didn't know it was going to be like an emotionally moving experience. I felt like crying the whole time I was out there. It was just incredible. And I just said, John, follow me. Follow my instructions. Do it. You can do it. I don't need him to be the next Evel Knievel. See, some people think that God wants you to be like, no. He loves you. You're very important to him. You're like his only child, even though there's billions of us, right? Just follow him. Just listen to what he has to say. You can do it. It's like riding a bike. And you'll never forget it once you learn how to do it. How will you respond to the calling of the Lord? Tactfully preach the gospel wherever God leads you. Passionately following the Master with all the details of your life. Patiently and consistently fishing for souls all over this community. Wholeheartedly embracing the ultimate by not worrying so much about the trivial. The older I get, the more I'm not so worried about those little trivial details. They'll take care of themselves. Obediently answering the call today. God is patiently waiting for you to respond to His call. Would you pray with me? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? We're going to bring our service to a close. Great, beautiful day. I'm so appreciative of those testimonies. Music was wonderful. I'm so glad all of you got to see a little snippet of what it was like to be at camp. But let's pretend we're all at camp for a minute. Do you remember back when your heart was fresh and you were a little more naive and you were willing to listen, willing to change? Look, I know a lot of you have been through major, major hurt. And as we just bow our heads and close our eyes before the Lord and you look into your heart, you're just not very happy about the way things have turned out. You've had some heartache. I talked to someone this morning who has a loved one who is really, really struggling with cancer. They don't know what they're going to do. The medicines are just terrible. 2 minutes later, I talked to an individual who has a brother who had a very, very severe form of cancer. And they did a check this week, and they found out it's gone. It's healed. We prayed for that man. Remember the psalm that says, He gives and takes away, He gives and takes away. I will choose to bless the Lord regardless. Sometimes He chooses to heal, sometimes He doesn't choose to heal. Why do Christians have to suffer? Why do Christians have to go through a hard time? I don't have the answer for that. But I can tell you, God knows what's going on in your life. He cares for you. He will help you through whatever you're going through. He may heal. He may choose to heal in a different way than what you think He should. What is God asking you to do today? Take your hurts, take your heartache, take your questions, take your doubts, take them to Him. You may be here, and what you really need to do today is accept the free gift of salvation that has been offered for you. It's like a Christmas gift. It's been purchased. It's been wrapped. It's sitting under the tree. All you got to do is walk over there and unwrap it and take it. And the way you unwrap this gift is by repenting of your sins. Believing that Jesus Christ died for you on the cross and rose from the grave. And if you think you were born a Christian, you're lying to yourself. You weren't. And if you think that maybe if you could just do enough good deeds, you could go to heaven, you're lying to yourself. You won't. You could never do enough good deeds. I never could. You need to be made pure, made holy, made clean. You need to be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Remember that song we sang just a minute ago? Grace, grace, God's grace, His free gift of salvation is available for you. Maybe you need to answer His call. Maybe you need to return. You're saved, but you've been just drifting away. I would encourage you to take advantage of our time of invitation. You might want to take some time and just kneel at this old-fashioned altar and spend some time alone in prayer. Specifically, service opportunities. I'm hoping, I'm praying that God will convict your heart about taking advantage of some service opportunities. You may be already involved in some service opportunities and you're just flat worn out. And you really just need some strength to make it because it's just exhausting. Maybe you're in the wrong ministry. You need to switch over to something you enjoy. I don't know. I can tell you one thing. Our teenagers are going to put you to shame because several of them have made ministry decisions this last week. And they're ready and raring to get their ministry team back up and rolling. How will you respond? Don't delay. I encourage you. Don't put it off. You may need to reconnect with the Lord today. You may need to become a disciple today. This is the moment of truth. Try to block out everything else that's going on in your life. And if that's you, if you're here today, believe me, God knew you would be. God drew you here. This is God's work. You want to give your heart to Christ today. You want to just get rid of the guilt and all the junk, the conviction that you've been dealing with because you have not yet been saved. Today, you want to give your heart to Jesus. I want to encourage you right now to pray and invite Christ into your life. He's knocking on your heart's door. Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." Will you open up and let Him in? He wants to come into your heart. But understand what you're getting into. You're getting into an eternal relationship that can never be broken. You're getting into a relationship that will take you to heaven when you die. Now, how do I know that? What about all the other religions? The other religions don't have a sovereign, infallible, provable, holy book. They have their holy books. But our book has been proven by evidences over and over and over and over. Jesus said, "I'm the way, I'm the truth, I'm the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." That's not my... I didn't make that up. There are not many roads to God. If you believe that, the Bible doesn't teach that. The Bible teaches there's one road to God, and His name is Jesus. And if you want to invite Him into your heart right now, I want to encourage you to do it. Why don't you pray right now? Let's focus on that one or two or three or ten right now that need to invite the Savior into their lives. And if you're saved, pray for those who don't know Jesus, but who are going to give their heart to Christ right now. Will you pray with me in your heart? You don't need to pray out loud. Just invite Christ into your life. Pray something like this. "Oh God in heaven, I need You. Lord Jesus, please come into my life now. I believe that You died for me, and I believe that You rose from the grave. As best as I know how, I receive into my life. Lord Jesus, please come into my life right now. Please forgive me of my sins and save me. Be my Lord and my Master." If you've sincerely given your heart to Christ today, you need to go public with it at some point. You need to request believer's baptism. I want to encourage you to do something about what God's done in your life. I'll be standing here at the service or after the service if you want to talk to me. But during our time of invitation, Christians, you need to be the one leading out. Students, if you made a big decision at camp that you need to let the church know about, this is your turn to come forward and do that. If God's working in your heart, I would ask that you, all of us, would stand together. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. Lord God, I pray as we stand in Your presence that You would do what only You can do during our time of invitation. Change hearts. Mold minds. Help us to answer Your call. Help us to do something about what we've been taught from Your Word today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If God's worked in your life and you've made a decision, you need someone to pray with you, come forward. I will pray with you at this time.
It's a voice that whispers my name. It's a kiss without